cfa.org.
Keep on pushing. I can't stop now.
Good afternoon. This is not the impeachment hearings. Those are over for today. It is Pushing Limits, KPFA's program by and about people with disabilities. Our guest this afternoon will be Michelle Mashburn. And Michelle is the director of the San Jose Peace and Justice Center, as well as being a person with a disability. Good afternoon, Michelle. Michelle and Michael, our engineer.
Hello.
That's more like it. Hello there. Tell us a little bit about yourself. How you came to be the director of a progressive nonprofit organization.
So I've been here a little over 3 years. The story to getting the job was kind of interesting. The Peace and Justice Center is a resource and action center for progressive activism in the South Bay area of the Bay Area of California. I was involved in a rally against the Super Bowl back in 2016 here in San Jose. And through that, I got connected with the Peace and Justice Center. They listed a job somewhere shortly after that. And I applied, and largely because even though we're in an old house, there's a lift in the back that was advocacy done by other people prior to me that got that in. So then I got the job, and I've been here since then. So
excellent. Yeah, so the advocacy works for everyone. I think I remember that whole detail. Back when I was the community advocate at the Independent Living Center down there, I made some noise about the old building not being accessible. Good to see all that hard work has paid off. Mm-hmm. And you tell me that you're running classes on how to incorporate Access for All into the center's programming?
It's not just the center's programming. I've done community outreach as well as outreach here and education efforts to include accessibility in much of what we do. The classes I've done are usually called Access for All, which means not just people with disabilities, but anybody who might be on the outlier in society, and the need to incorporate them into the progressive activism that we do, as well as that, you know, the community groups that are affiliated here are doing as well. This includes both here at the center as well as at rallies and vigils and other educational classes and other venues. So it's, I've done classes for, I think I've done 3 or 4 classes at this point. And then I have, it's an ongoing process of educating people on accessibility and the realities of how the ADA doesn't necessarily ensure people with disabilities have a seat at the table.
Yeah, how's that going? I've noticed that, counterintuitively, people in the progressive movement seem to be just as ableist, the analog of racist, sexist, homophobic against people with disabilities as anybody else. How much of that have you run into?
Extensively. I think this falls into the reality that people tend to think that we don't have enough money, and tend to think it costs money to be accessible. And there's some cases where, yes, it does. But if you start something with the intention of accessibility, you can end up being inclusive for more people and deal with the complications that arise because you set that intention at the very beginning. Ableism is what I call is the last one of the hidden isms in society, because it's not talked about. It's not included. People don't realize that universal design is a much better framework than the ADA could ever be. The ADA was important when it was passed, and then since then it's like everybody's, well, this is ADA accessible, but that doesn't guarantee someone with a disability can get through in the door and be a participant in that activity. So I hit it a lot within the progressive communities, and people think they understand it, but 9 times out of 10, it's a very basic understanding, and it's hard to kind of navigate because people don't realize their internalized ableism as well, myself included with that.
Right, yet ableism is everywhere. The guy who's being impeached infamously mocked a reporter for the New York Times who has a disability, mimicking his hand movements. But that the furor over that only lasted for one news cycle. Imagine if he did mocked an African-American in that way. He might still be there. And you also tell me that you've come to be a community resource for people looking to be more inclusive. So who's approaching you?
So I reached out. Well, I was asked by Silicon Valley Humanist to do a presentation on Access for All there. I've also done advocacy work within the Green Party locally, Santa Clara County Green Party. There are other community groups that frequently ask me, you know, how can we be more accessible? And ask me for assistance in setting their accessibility policies, you know, what they bring into each event that they're planning. What are the bare bones basic of access that they want to provide? You know, whether it's, you know, and that has to be done within the parameters of what an organization or a grassroots group can afford to do. But, you know, having that intention and answering some simple questions around access can be a starting point for that.
Excellent. So that's the only group, Silicon Valley Humanists, that's bothered?
No.
Good.
So we are, that's the one I've done a class on. Civic is also another group that reached out to me to do a class, which Civic is, I never remember what they're...
Okay, but it's Civic. Anyone down there? And not the big theater on San Carlos Street.
That could it's an interreligious
which I
faith
hope is accessible.
So it's Silicon Valley Interreligious Faith, Interreligious Council. I did a Access for All in faith-based organizing. Then we have a community group of roughly close over 40 community groups here at the center. I've interacted with Democratic Socialists of America of Silicon Valley. I've interacted with... I've done Women's March, San Jose. I've talked with them. I've advocated for accessibility. I've been a go-to person for answering some of those questions. More recently, I've had not necessarily them calling on me, but I've called groups out for the lack of inclusion in their planning out of events, and that's included different groups that are doing advocacy and activism and governmental policy shifts, and they're not completely being accessible. I mean, they'll do ADA, but they don't know that ADA doesn't necessarily get people in the door.
Right, and that, well, it would be a problem. In California, it's an issue, but still. And the bigger issue seems to me that, you know, people with disabilities are being left out of the progressive movement. Now, with all this going on around us, it's all hands on deck time, you know, even prosthetic ones.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so how do we get past that?
A lot of this is what I do in the background. So, you know, it's because it is all hands on deck, and it's a whole lot easier to assume that I can't get through a door because I use a power wheelchair, that I can't make it to a meeting because I know the intention wasn't there to include everybody. When you start, you know, and that's where my outreach kind of goes. It continues to be pushing towards groups that that it doesn't have to be complicated to include accessibility and to be inclusive of all groups. So when you start with a basic platform of we want to include as many people as we can, you know, then you get the word out that, you know, it's everybody can come here, or that we're willing to work with anybody regardless of difference. And sometimes that's the hardest part, is making that intention clear. We do need everybody's voice, and we need everybody's ability, no matter what that ability is. We need to realize that people function and people excel in different ways. And just because we want to do a letter writing doesn't mean that somebody else can't do a video of what's important to them, and or work together with somebody to write something out. So these are all skills and talents that I try to convey to different people to bring them up and more aware of how they're being intentionally and unintentionally ableist and, excluding people in their process. It's kind of like with the presidential websites and not having accessibility on social media platforms and things like that. You know, we need slow and sure to find that one person that you can get to understand, and then that change hopefully creates more of a cascade and continues to ripple to create more awareness around those issues.
Yes, making access go viral. I like this.
Yeah.
Right, now tell us more about the local peace economy. You're working on this with Code Pink, which, by the way, is very exciting for San Jose. I mean, you know, by Bay Area standards, it is not exactly a progressive hotbed. And yet here you are with Code Pink bringing a local peace economy down there and hopefully building some access into it.
Right. So to me, Code Pink, their local peace economy is about connecting people. It's wartime. America's involvement in war has historically created barriers between communities. Also, you have attitudes in the United States that people, cult of independence, and the work ethic of if you just work hard enough, you can succeed in what you're doing. All of these things have created silos of people that they want to be in their cause, or they want to live in their house and not necessarily be connected with people around them, whether it's through social media or email or face-to-face interactions. So the first time I started seeing local peace economy stuff, they have an amazing graphic that kind of lists all of their causes, all of the interconnection of it. And in addition to that, there's the disability justice framework that was developed by Sins Invalid and the many disabled activists of color that has the amazing image as well. And the two of those images go nicely together. They kind of say very similar things for very different reasons. But to break down the barriers between people is the beginning of that dialogue that we need to have, where people stop seeing each other as competition and they go back to the earth as being a in local peace economy, the earth is viewed as, important in that connection process. So you connect, you end up breaking the barriers down, and through that connection process, we can then create a better, better reality for those people that we're connected with. Here at the Peace and Justice Center, I've connected with various people in the area, regardless of their status in the world. Some of them are unhoused. Some of them are, have come to us for a community meal, or they've come to us and everybody, I think, in the Bay Area, or a large number of people, struggle to make their ends meet. So it's like, how can we connect and make this battle a little bit less? And that's what local peace economy to me is. And then added to that is the disability justice piece, which just kind of goes over that nicely. And slow and sure, I'm trying to bring more awareness of disability justice into the work that Code Pink does locally, as well as some that they're doing in the Bay Area. And then I have some ripple effects that have happened outside of that. So,
excellent. I'm just trying to picture this chart with all the arrows of interconnectivity going all across it. Now, here comes Michelle drawing a new oval and labeling it access and disability. And I'm wondering where all those arrows go. You can think about that while I remind everyone that this is Pushing Limits, the show by and about people with disabilities here on KPFA 94.1 FM. And another thing, I didn't realize that you supervised interns.
Yes,
at the P&J. That opens up a whole, I can just imagine the ableism coming out. How dare this disabled person boss me around?
Actually, that's not been my experience at all. I think the most extreme experience I had was just the reaction of surprise when they first meet me, because my first interaction may just be online or whatever, and then I interact face to face when I'm interviewing them for that, for the opening or for the position. And through that, I mean, each one of my interns has their own struggle. Each one of the interns, because our society is a struggle right now. So we get this interesting opportunity for me to rewrite their understanding of disability and to challenge them around the ableism that is inherent from the school system. You know, schools teach that people with disabilities should be behind closed doors, should not be a part of the mainstream classroom. You know, we don't fund enough educational stuff for students with disabilities. So with all of that, you get, it's an interesting opportunity to teach the students something different. I did recently do a talk at a local high school here with a club around intersectionality, and that was really powerful as well. Even though, as I got into the room that they were having the talk at, you know, there was barrier after barrier after barrier, and I had to rearrange the furniture in order to get to the front of the room, you know. So I more experienced the structural ableism than I experienced the interpersonal ableism at this point.
Yeah, and there is a lot of structural ableism out there. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm actually in a heated discussion on Nextdoor down in San Jose, where I live as well, about the vaunted bike lanes that go all over town. Our mayor even rides a bike, and he managed to get clipped by a car a few months ago. And he doesn't have a disability. So, you know, how are these lanes working out for you?
So my street, either luckily or unluckily, was one of the first streets in the downtown core of San Jose that got the bike lanes implemented. I had fortunately been able to attend one of the workshops for the bike lanes, and I was aware of some of what they were trying to do. Which I think what they're trying to do is very positive. But at the same time, their execution of that was a little bit problematic. When I was in that original meeting, and the first thing I saw was that there's no curb cuts except for at the end of a block. And those curb cuts at the ends of the blocks won't necessarily help me if I have to park in the middle. So, and then I live in a building that is mostly seniors, and thinking of all the people dropping us off, I was like, well, how can this work? Where does somebody let me off? And they were like, oh, well, that's ADA. You know, that's something different. And ADA just says they have to have possibly one curb cut at each end of the street, and that they need only one ADA parking space through that whole block. That may be what it is. That's probably not the exact thing. But so that started this process of, you know, they did the bike lanes. There's a whole mess of situations that show how me as a disabled person, one change can cascade into a huge problem, because, you know, outreach paratransit can't easily pick somebody up in front of my building unless they block the bike lane now. There are people on bikes, you know, for me, if I am ambulating that day and walking from a car to the house, to the apartment, you know, it's I have to lift my walker up over the sidewalk and then get my stuff out of the car somewhere in the midst of that. And it's quite an ordeal to try to do. It really severely limits my independence and my autonomy. The flip side of that, though, is that the bike team people and I have sat down to have conversations around this. And the biggest thing with that and my main point is that my feeling is access cannot be determined by a code. Access needs to be determined for all populations in the individual areas that they're making those changes. So in order to make the change, they needed to come to my building and talk with the 200 apartment units, people from those apartment units, and ask them, how is this going to impact us? And how is this going to affect us? And what changes did they need to create in their plan? They did their generic outreach plan, but it didn't really include those most impacted by that reality.
And I'm surprised, to say the least, to find out there are that many barriers in a building designed for senior citizens. Lovely.
Yeah, well, they are now working on a new plan for in front of my building. I spent a long year trying to get change and trying to get them to understand what was going on. They're currently working on a revised plan because with raised sidewalks, there's an automatic issue where if the bike lane is a protected bike lane, how do you get from the car to the where you need to be on the street if you have a step you have to go up? So it's been a long process. I'm hopeful at this point. The San Jose bike people are talking more about finding ways to incorporate universal design here in Santa Clara County versus the Americans with Disabilities Act requirements. But there's still a lot of hiccups, I'm sure, along ahead of us. So,
sadly, this is not the first time that bike riders and wheelchair users have gone head to head. Most recently with the variously inaccessible designs for BART's Fleet of the Future cars, which are rolling out there. The bike people wanted places to put bikes. They didn't really care that that meant a pole would be right in front of the door. So someone like yourself coming on the train with a wheelchair would run right smack in the pole.
Right.
This is not a good thing. We want more people, and all the wheeled vehicles should be working together. I don't hear many complaints from bike riders when there are ramps going into buildings. They weren't put there for bikes.
Right.
And, all this nuts and bolts stuff, even though, you're the director of a nonprofit agency, one would think your life would be pretty sweet, but the fact that you actually have income puts your benefit situation in some kind of purgatory.
Right. It makes my working is a very positive thing. I've found a lot of myself through what I do. But at the same time, navigating Social Security disability, Medi-Cal, complex medical issues, multiple medical issues, the requirement I would not be able to work if I didn't have my in-home support workers. All of these things affect me. And if I make $2 over what I'm allowed to make, that could mean that I could get bumped out of this program or that program. There are supports, there are ways to extend resources and your benefits, but it is piecemeal. It's not connected. So that piecemeal creates kind of a scary scenario that even with the Ticket to Work program, things like that, it still is precarious to consider that. The other reality for me personally is that I do not have a developmental disability. I'm an adult onset disability. So with that, there's a lack of a safety net there, because if I'm seen by the powers that be as capable of working and engaging in a living wage because I've earned enough or whatever, it's not as easy to get back on benefits. It's not easy for anybody, but it's not, there's a there's a varying level of security depending on at what age you become disabled.
Sounds fairly discriminatory. And, well, you certainly don't need to tell me about the sorry state of transportation in the South Bay. It took me a couple of hours to get up here to do the show today, and I don't even use a wheelchair.
Right.
I can only imagine. And, of course, as the director of the Peace and Justice Center, your presence is presumably requested all over town.
Unfortunately, I have to turn away or decline a number of requests unless they can meet me closer to where my home is. The high school class that I talked about, if I'm going to take public transit to someplace or if I'm taking paratransit to someplace, there are a lot of hoops and loops. One day I wasn't working that day, which gave me more capacity to deal with taking a bus to and from one place to another. But something that would take a 5 minutes to drive to took me almost an hour to get from point A to point. I think it was a little more than 5 minutes to drive, maybe 10-minute drive. But it was almost an hour because I had a bus transfer. And, of course, transfers are not timed in Santa Clara County, which means that you end up never knowing when the next bus is going to get there. So it took me a significant period of time to get from point A to point B. When I was attending the high school class and scheduling paratransit, it is the law that you request a trip pick up at 1 p.m., that they can give you anything from 12 p.m. to 2 p.m., regardless of whether you actually aren't done at 12 p.m. or 12:30 or not. So I ended up waiting 2 hours for my return vehicle because of the timing that they could fit me in on paratransit. And there's not very many ramp taxis or accessible taxis in the South Bay that are not currently contracted with the paratransit organization.
Sounds pretty horrible. I can just imagine if Lyft or Uber tried to treat riders like that. And of course, neither of them are very accessible. And on that note, we will begin to bring this week's edition of Pushing Limits to a close. Our guest has been Michelle Mashburn from the San Jose Peace and Justice Center. She's the director there. Any final thoughts?
Just thank you for doing this segment and for inviting me to speak on it. I appreciate hopefully getting different levels of awareness out to different people around the issues of disability.
All right. And, since the word for the day is impeachment, is there any kind of disability angle to this whole thing?
Impeachment is like a whole nother area. There have been a lot of bad things that have happened. And, like you led with his treatment of, his mocking of a disabled reporter. And I think the fact that that person was a reporter frequently gets lost in the mix.
Yep.
So it's...
He was working, too, for the New York Times, the paper of record.
Yep. So it's a complicated scenario, and we need to get bad people out of office. That's all I can say.
And that'll do it, folks. To Education Today comes your way in this time slot next week. Thank you to Michael Cohn, our engineer. Keep on pushing.
The 2019 annual Craneway Crafts Fair is a Bay Area cultural treasure. The fair takes place December 21st and 22nd from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. on both days in the gorgeous Craneway Pavilion in Richmond, California. The fair showcases 200 diverse exhibitors, including both master artisans and emerging newcomers. Their original art and crafts fill the pavilion, along with fair trade and nonprofit vendors, live entertainment, and food catered by local catering businesses. Again, that's December 21st and 22nd from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. For more information, visit kpfa.org. This wheelchair-accessible event is a benefit for KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and